Gentlemen, it is a pleasure to present in front of this audience the study of the Intramural Research Program at the National Institute of Aging in Baltimore. I apologize for my voice. I am there's some residual from a flu, so once I may have to blow my nose during my presentation, and I hope you can, you know, the excuse is, you know, physiological. I'm happy to tell you that the aging of the population is probably the most important social and medical phenomenon that is investing the last century. Many years ago, at this point, it's almost 40 years ago, when somebody asked me to be a geopathologist, they said that everything was changing because the aging of the population, our patient system, our healthcare system, the way we conceptualize our family, the way we take care of our mother and father. And he was right. And he also told me that the aging of the population was completely unavoidable. Those that were becoming old were already born. And unless there was a very tragic epidemic around the world, the aging of the population was completely an unavoidable phenomenon. And you see that already in 2015, the percentage of people over the age of 60 is about 20% in North America and in most of Europe. But the projection of increase are tremendously speeding up, so that in most of the world, with the exception of Africa, there will be between 20-25% of the population over the age of 65. And we're experiencing now a very, very important moment in history. It's about when the number of people under the age of 5 and the people over the age of 60 will be crossing. So for the first time in history in this world, there will be more people over the age of 60 than people under the age of 5. And you can imagine how it has you know, tremendous consequences in terms of our social organization, and then we need to reconceptualize our pension system, the way we support and sustain our older population. I also say that no social care, no medical system can take care of this problem long term unless we can compress the morbidity and the disability that are strongly associated with the aging process. And so the research on aging, especially the research that aims to reduce the burden of disease and disability with aging, it's become it's focusing on the center of attention from NIA, and I would say it's not really a topic addressed by NIA, but is being taken by many, many others to their focus on disease. So the idea that the aging of the population was occurring as a roots in the past. This is a Baltimore Sun Morning journal that in June 6, 1948 was already showing that there was a gain in the older population. And it's funny that they focus on mobility, because that's exactly, you know, what you know, the geriatric and gerontology community focus in nowadays. The principal focus is to maintain physical mobility and cognitive function in old age. Baltimore occupy, independent from NIA, a very important role historically on the research on aging. This is another cut from the Baltimore Sun. We are in 1949, and the hospital decided, in collaboration with the national, the NHLBI, to dedicate a ward to the study of aging. It was probably the seed for the growth of the National Institute of Aging, and an attention in the media. And I want to read you some pointers that one of the Titanic figures in gerontology, Dr. Nathan Schock, was telling to a newspaper. But the gerontologists give us only a few pointers. Few of the time, Nathan Schock said, don't ever accept exercise at the age of 40. Won't keep you young. Hey, if overdone, ask an old age. If you already are middle age, don't play or work to the point of short of breath. Don't indulge in diet fat in the hope of staying young. If you want to give up eating eggs or drinking milk, it's for your life, provide you substitute an item with equal nutrition. I can go on. And I will say that we have gone long and we gain a lot more understanding of what is important to preserve encourage healthy aging in the population. Okay, is a step forward. The first research center on aging was created in Baltimore, was called the Geriatric Research Center. This is 1964. At the time, the study on aging, the most important and longest study of aging in the world, the Baltimore Longitudinal Study of Aging, had already started. And NEA occupied, the intramural program occupied this building for many, many years, until recently. And the building is still there. It's probably going to come down over the next couple of years. But after that, there would be in 1973, the Congress finally decided to establish the National Institute of Aging as one of the main institutes of the National Institute of Health, and the NIA has grown tremendously and is now spread in many different locations. The Biomedical Research Center in our main building, the GRC, as mentioned before, was abandoned a few years ago in around 2003. And then we have a clinical program on the other side of the bay of Harbor Hospital. A few of our laboratories are at the NIH campus. We have a study that looks at the interface between socioeconomic status and race in the neighborhood of Baltimore. It's called the Handles. And then we have a epidemiological group that is in Bethesda, the Gateway Building, and a non-human primate facility close to Bethesda in a place called Portsville. As you can see that the complexity of the history has grown really tremendously. This is an organigram, an organizational chart of what the intramural program represents. So NEA is a, organization that is divided into two main parts. The intramural research program, the extramural research program. Extramural research program is really the organization that provides grants to academic institutions across the United States, and the director is Dr. Richard Hodes, the deputy director is Dr. Marie Bernard. And as you can see, it's coordinated by the Division of Extramural Activity and an administration office, and then a number of groups, and we'll focus today on the intramural group, which is the part of NIA that we conduct directly research on aging, while the other are mostly giving grant to institutions and collaborating with them to establish the mission of NIA. NIA mission, which is shared by the intramural and the extramural community, is support conduct research on aging and aging-related disease and special problems and need of the aged, and develop high-skilled scientists in the aging field. Those will be the scientists in the future that we take this very, very seriously. Develop and maintain state-of-the-art research to accelerate progress on aging, and then the dissemination of this information in the public, so that we can advance research and also collaborate with private institutions in developing new treatment that relieves the burden of disease and disability in the elderly. This is an organizational chart. I am the scientific director of the entire unit. that entail a little more than 50 principal investigators and more than 600 people that work as supporters. And these are, as you can see, I will not go through each one of them, but the institute covers a number of topics that are relevant for aging. And I will point out that many of these laboratories, directly or indirectly, are dedicated to the study of neurodegenerative disease, because this is one of the main issues that that is affected by aging. But from this count of different prospective genetic study of diabetes, longevity and lifespan, cardiovascular disease, we think that all these problems come up from a central core of biological changes that occur with aging, so that a root of many different diseases in different organs is the biology of aging. This is a new concept that we call geroscience that tries to establish what are common biological traits that are across different diseases. I'll talk, get back to that later on. The institute is incredibly productive. We have almost 600 publications in peer-reviewed journals every year. And I can tell you that because I need to read all of them in order to do the internal clearance. And many of these publications, as you can see in the map, are done in collaboration with other institutions. As you can expect, you know, our most important collaborator is Johns Hopkins University because it's located in the same city. And so these publications are highly impact. So, for example, if you take the 1% most cited papers in the literature, you know, 6% of our papers produced are in the top 1%, and 22% are in the top 10%. So we are really competing with the largest and most successful research institution around the world. Today is walk you through quickly, you know, just to give you a flavor to some of the selected accomplishments that were you know, by NIA over the last few years. We can, I don't pretend to be exhaustive here, I'm just going to give you a glimpse and give you some very simple explanation about them, but it will give you an idea of what we're working on. One of that is happening with aging is that aging is the strongest and most important risk factor of almost any chronic disease. And so what is happening is that all people tend to have two or disease very, very often. We call this condition multimorbidity or comorbidity. And in fact, two or more diseases is currently the most frequent condition of people over the age of 65. This is extremely important because we have created a medical culture that focuses on one disease. There are guidelines for treating people that are affected by one disease, and only seldom and very, very superficially, they consider that people that have one disease also have other diseases. And so the care for the elderly, not an established book, but it needs to be individualized patient by patient, and gerontologists, you know, more than a medical science. I think that are performing a medical art. And see that you look at the number of disease longitudinal, each one of these, if you look at the right panel, each one of these pair of line is a cohort that entered in a longitudinal study. In this case, is the Baltimore longitudinal study of aging. And you can see that the number of chronic disease not only increase with age, but the rate of increase with aging, so it's not linear. So that in the over the age of 90, 80% of the people have at least three or more chronic diseases. And this is important because chronic disease associated with some of the most important changes that occur with aging. And one of them that we concentrate on is inflammation. Not all the people tend to have high circulating level of pro-inflammatory markers. These inflammatory markers are not justified by any infection or condition that triggered them. And also these are associated with a number of different outcomes. And you can see that not only the baseline level of IL-6, which is one of these inflammatory markers, is associated correctionally with having more disease, but it's also associated with a steep increase of number of chronic diseases over time. And it's interesting because inflammation is by far today the only risk factor for prospective increase in multimorbidity that we have identified, but we don't know how to treat it, how to address it clinically. And inflammation is important because inflammation is also one of the strongest predictors of losing the ability to maintain autonomy. This is a study that I published in 1999. The first published study showed that the level of IL-6 at baseline predicts the development of disability over time above a certain threshold. And this threshold and this study have been later on replicated by many, many other authors. On a topic, we do a lot of study on the brain, and we do a lot of studies that are dealing with neuroimaging. This is what was done in the BLSA by Dr. Susan Lesnik, who is leading this part of the BLSA, and show you by using the accumulation of Pittsburgh compound by PET, which is a radionuclide, that there is accumulation of beta amyloid individuals that tend to lose the memory. The accumulation of beta amyloid that you see in green yellow here is much less in individuals that have stable memory in the following 4 years. Another factor for the accumulation of beta amyloid that is amenable to intervention is sleep. We published probably the first paper showing that a longitudinal accumulation of beta amyloid occurs much faster. A sweet spot appears to be between 6 and 7 hours, and more than 7 hours or less than 6 hours seems to be in the case associated with some accumulation of beta amyloid. This is an rate of cortical thinning over the 8-year follow-up, and you can see that the decline in cortical thinning, which is really brain atrophy, occurs differentially in people that tend to be experiencing cognitive impairment and memory problem, and then there are specific areas of the brain that tend to be more affected than others, and that more predictive of cognitive decline. A really great attention is now dedicated to sensory problem. We have a study showing that the loss of smell is predictive, certainly, of Parkinson's disease. It is one of the strongest predictors of Parkinson's disease, and it can be also associated with cognitive decline. With one of these studies, but there are many, many other studies that confirm this association. The replication of the olfactive nerves appear to be one of the parameter that is most affected by neurodegenerative disease. The mechanism is still unknown, but the smell test has been included in some of the most powerful predictive algorithms that are used now clinically. This is to give you a glimpse of genes that seem to be associated with Parkinson's disease, and I'm showing you this because many of the monogenic and moderate risk variants have been identified by the Laboratory of Neurogenetics in our institute. this is a different representation of the same, where by working on meta-analysis, collect data throughout the world, you can see that you know, many of these variants that explain small percentage of the incidence of Parkinson's disease have been identified, and the current work that NIA is doing is to interpret this gene to understand what mechanisms that underneath this association that can target it for prevention and cure. And the topic that we are focusing on is epigenetics. Any epigenetics in general is the idea that the expression of our DNA is regulated by a number of mechanisms. One of these mechanisms is the methylation in the CpG site, where there is the cytosine and the guanosine that attach one to the other with the phosphor bond. So we call that CpG islands. Steve Horvath and others have identified a set of these CpG sites that change systematically with aging. This is their original study showing that in a training set, they were able to identify a set of 354 CpG sites that are strongly correlated with aging, and then they applied the same formula in a test set, and they found that the correlation was still very strong. To give you some, what this means is that if you see a drop of blood on the floor and go there, you can study the methylation in that drop of blood and estimate the age of this individual with a precision of 1.5 plus or minus 1.5 years, something that, you know, 10 or 15 years ago was thought to be impossible. This suggests that there is a biological clock predictable, the track aging, and not only this biological clock can be replicated in any other population. These are data from the Chianti study and the DLSA, but independent of chronological age, methylation age, or the genetic clock as it has been defined so far, is also predictive of another outcome. And this is, for example, a study showing that the genetic clock predicts mortality in the chronological age. And we are trying to understand what are the mechanisms of this association, but also in other clocks that are not tuned on chronological age, but more on phenotypic age, so we can predict what are the individuals that are aging faster than others. Another issue that we are focusing on, and it's a traditional interest of NIA, is color restriction. Is this trans intervention that is associated with longevity in animal model. This is traditional, you know, slide showing that you can increase by almost 50 to 60% longevity in mice by just doing a 25% color restriction. Also, you know, the dose effect. So even if you increase the color restriction up to 65%, you see a substantial increase. Some of these effects of color restriction has been confirmed in low animal model, in worms, in mice, but when we switch to higher, for example, non-human primates, like here, the effects are less consistent, and there are studies that show that color restriction has some effectiveness in some studies, but not in other studies. And for example, the only study of color restriction, which was funded by NIA in humans, was unable to demonstrate any effect on the aging phenotype, although those that were color restricted tended to have a low level of inflammation in the blood, and we have seen how inflammation it's important with aging. But there was no effectiveness in changing metabolic parameter, in changing resting metabolic rate, and changing other parameters that are supposed to be biomarkers of aging. number of study on by the on glucose metabolism. Then you know how the glucose tolerance test change with aging. I'll show you this next one, and they give you power of having a longitudinal study that started in 1958 and is still ongoing. We were able to track back for 30 years people that in the end developed diabetes. So you can see that 28 years before, the signal of diabetes were already present, and these people had no idea that they will have developed diabetes 28 years later. With BADS, it is a new avenue, and we study taste buds based on the assumption that taste buds are like mini pancreatic islands that they secrete insulin, glucagon, GLP-1, some of the study in ghrelin, exactly where they are. And so it's possible that in the future, the stem cells that are derived easily by this taste bud could be used as insulin. And, we studied them in the Baltimore longitudinal study aging. The taste buds tend to decline with aging, and they become atrophic, and we have some initial evidence that the lower the taste bud, the more problematic is the effect on glucose tolerance. One last argument that is very, very exciting now. We know now that cells communicate each other by producing small vesicles. The small vesicles contain cargos with the molecules that are signaling to other cells, and so we found a way to isolate those vesicles in the circulation, and using immunoprecipitation, we can selectively tell where the cell, those vesicles come from. Those that come from the brain, that come from the muscle. So we have virtual biopsies that do not require biopsies, but can be done by using just in the brain. These have been studied mostly in cancer and pregnancy, but new work suggests that they can be used for early diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's disease. And apparently, there is evidence that only in the preclinical stage of Alzheimer's disease, there is effective insulin resistance occurring in the brain that is not diffused to the general body, so that may explain some of the early stages, the pathophysiological changes that occur in the brain. And I will skip this. First, geroscience. So I talked about it very, very quickly. What we think is that the biology of aging and the biology of disease are really connected, and that provides us some clue on what are the biological mechanisms that we need to start to understand why older people tend to have more disease and more likely to have functional and cognitive decline. And this is consistent with what an important paper, the hallmarks of aging, was published recently. This is probably the slide that they've been shown over the last 3 or 4 years. There are identified mechanisms that, and we work on many of these mechanisms. I'll skip this just to give you a. So to conclude, we think that aging is at the root of any chronic disease, and changing in body composition. And that this change in body composition, the plant, and other domains of the aging phenotypes, the change that lead to false physical and cognitive frailty and of the so-called geriatric syndrome. And in order to prevent the geriatric syndrome, we need to go back and understand the root of these mechanisms. So what we're doing is to define three levels of mechanisms with biological aging, study how the biological age affect the phenotype that we see in older people and how the change in this phenotype are affecting cognitive and physical function. And the ultimate scope is to prevent physical and cognitive disability, but we are aware that without understanding biological mechanisms that are underneath these changes, this would be very, very difficult. And we have people that are working at all levels of these minor leagues, at all levels of biological age, phenotypic age, functional aging, and so our approach is probably translational. And though you use sophisticated biological and molecular biology technique, the scope is to really affect functionality. And I could not do this lead this group without a lot of people that helped me, and this is just the scientific direct office team that is helping coordinate the work done by NIH. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope I have bored you too much, and you can certainly email to me, and I will be happy to address any question you may have. Thanks.